There's a big difference between real mental illness and minor mental disturbances.
Let me put it this way, Doctor. Could Captain Queeg have been disabled by the severe strain of command?
That's absurdly hypothetical.
Is it? Have you ever had any sea duty, Doctor?
No.
Have you ever been at sea?
No.
How long have you been in the Navy?
5 months.
Have you ever had any dealings with ship captains before this case?
No.
Then I suggest that you cannot set yourself up as an authority on the strain of command, and thus you may be completely wrong about Captain Queeg. Your witness.
1 minute, Doctor. Esteemed counsel for defense has raised an interesting point. Now, in private practice, did you ever have patients who had to deal with complicated command decisions? Men such as plant managers, industrialists, etc.?
Yes, quite a few. Including some flyers who have to decide questions of life and death every day. I've written a book on the subject.
And in those cases, could you detect where a neurosis might damage the ability to make decisions correctly and at the right time?
Absolutely.
And in your examination of Lieutenant Commander Queeg, you found no such damage. Is that right?
Absolutely right.
Thank you, Doctor. That will be all.
Smart guy, Charlie.
He's sure gonna bear down on me. And that's the way I saw it. I felt it was my duty as a naval officer. Captain Queeg was sick, mentally ill, and I had to take over. And I tell you honestly, if I had to do it again, I'd do it.
Thank you, Mr. Merrick. Your witness, sir.
Mr. Merrick, just a few questions. Would you say your grades in high school were average?
Lower than average.
And in college?
Lower than average.
What training have you had in psychiatry or medicine?
None.
Where did you get the idea that Captain Queeg was mentally ill?
Out of books.
What books? Name the titles.
Oh, I can't remember them.
Mr. Merrick, define schizophrenia.
I can't.
What is a manic depressive?
I don't know.
What's the difference between the words paranoid and paranoia?
I don't know.
In truth, then, Mr. Merrick, you don't know what you're talking about when you discuss mental illness.
Oh, I didn't say I knew much about it.
Yet you thought you knew enough to commit an act that was outright mutiny.
I wanted to save the ship.
But doctors, responsible doctors, Mr. Merrick, have found that the captain wasn't mentally ill, haven't they?
They weren't in the ship.
But isn't the reverse possible? Mr. Merrick, isn't it possible that under pressure you became erratic and couldn't understand the captain's sound decision? Isn't that possible?
It's possible.
Between a captain and his executive officer, who is presumed by the Navy to have the better judgment in ship handling?
The captain.
One last question, Mr. Merrick. If the diagnosis of expert doctors is correct, then you're guilty as charged, aren't you?
I guess maybe so.
No more questions.
No further questions.
You may step down, Mr. Merrick.
Take it easy. You've just seen the first act. The finale's still to come.
Good afternoon, gentlemen. I assume command of an extremely sloppy, badly handled ship. I was determined to bring this ship into line. Lieutenant Merrick, I may say, opposed me from the very first. Maybe he thought I was crazy to keep trying.
In your judgment, was your ship on the verge of foundering when the executive officer assumed command?
Well, now, as you gentlemen know, a typhoon is an extreme hazard at all times, but the ship was riding well. Lieutenant Merrick, however, went into a panic and ran amok. He acted under the delusion that he and he alone could save the ship. Ensign Willis Keith, a totally unreliable and disloyal officer, combined with them against me at this crucial time. It was bad luck for them, really. I bear them no malice. I'm extremely sorry for them.
No more questions.
A word of caution before you proceed with the examination, Mr. Greenwald. The court recognizes that the defense is compelled to try to challenge the competence of Lieutenant Commander Queeg. Nevertheless, all the requirements of legal ethics and military respect remain in force.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Queeg, during a period when the Kane was towing targets, Did you ever steam over your own tow line and cut it?
Objection. I beg the court's indulgence. But I must say the defense outrages the dignity of this proceeding.
The judge advocate wants the defense to switch to a guilty plea. He thinks the report of the psychiatrist closes the case. But I say it is up to you line naval officers, not doctors, to judge the captain's performance of duty. And I must review that performance of duty for the Navy to render a judgment.
Objection overruled.
Now, sir, did you ever steam over your own tow line and cut it?
Well, I for one, am happy to dispose of this particular slander. During the time we were towing the target, I noticed some anti-aircraft bursts close aboard, and naturally, I turned to avoid them.
And you continued to turn in a full circle?
Well, my helmsman, a very unreliable man, failed to warn me that we were coming around 360 degrees. I caught it in time and instantly reversed course. To the best of my knowledge, we didn't steam over the tow line.
I see. Now, besides the anti-aircraft bursts, did nothing else distract you?
No, not that I recall.
Well, Captain, weren't you engaged in reprimanding a seaman named Dlugacz at length for having his shirt tail out while the ship turned 360 degrees?
Well, yes, I reprimanded him, but that only took 2 seconds.
Mm-hmm. Now, on the morning the Kane escorted attack boats of Marines to the beach, did your orders include dropping a yellow dye marker?
I don't recall.
Did you drop a yellow dye marker?
I don't recall.
Now, Captain, didn't you steam several hundred yards ahead of the attack boats, drop a yellow dye marker, and retire at high speed, leaving the boats to make the beach on their own?
The question is abusive and flagrantly leading.
Mr. Greenwald, there can be no more serious charge against an officer than cowardice under fire.
Sir, may I make one thing clear? It is not the defense's contention that Lieutenant Commander Queeg is a coward. Quite the contrary. The defense assumes that no man who rises to command a United States naval ship can possibly be a coward, and that therefore, if he commits questionable acts under fire, the explanation must be elsewhere.
You may resume your examination.
Captain, you seem to be the victim of constantly disloyal officers.
Now, I didn't say that. Only some of them were disloyal.
Mr. Keith and Mr. Merrick, for instance.
Yes.
Now, Mr. Queeg, this is a fitness report you wrote on Mr. Merrick. 1 July 1944, 1 month before he relieved you. Do you recognize it?
Yes, I do.
Would you mind reading your comments on Mr. Merrick?
This officer's report is wrong.
I don't believe the court can hear you, Mr. Queeg.
This officer's improved in performance of duty since his last fitness report. He's consistently loyal, unflagging, thorough, courageous, and efficient. He's recommended for transfer to the regular Navy. Now, in relation to that report, I'd like to say that...
Thank you, sir. Captain, did you ever turn your ship upside down in a vain search for a key that did not exist?
I don't know what lies have been sworn to in this court, but I'd like to set you straight on this matter right here and now. A key definitely did exist.
May it please the court, the witness is understandably agitated by this ordeal, and I request a recess to give him a brief...
I don't want a recess. I'll answer all questions right here and now.
Did you conduct such a search?
Yes, I did. As usual, my disloyal officers failed me, and the key couldn't be found.
As a matter of actual fact, wasn't this whole fuss over a quart of strawberries?
The pilfering of food in large amounts or small is one of the most serious occurrences on board ship.
Yes, but didn't you learn the mess boys had eaten the strawberries and that you were conducting a search for an imaginary key?
I repeat, the key was not imaginary. And I don't know anything about mess boys eating strawberries.
Captain, have you no recollection of a conversation with an Ensign Harding just prior to his leaving the Kane?
What about it?
Well, didn't Ensign Harding tell you that the mess boys ate the strawberries?
All that I remember is that he was very grateful for his transfer. His wife was ill in the States.
Captain, do you know where Ensign Harding is now?
Well, I have no way of knowing.
Ensign Harding is in San Diego. His wife is fully recovered. He has already been summoned and can be flown up here in 3 hours if necessary. Would it serve any useful purpose to have him testify?
No. I don't see any need of that. Now that I recall, he might have said something about mess boys, and then again, he might not. I questioned so many men, and Harding was not the most reliable officer.
I'm afraid the defense has no other recourse than to produce Ensign Harding.
Now, there's no need for that. I know exactly what he'll tell you. Lies. He was no different from any other officer in the wardroom. They were all disloyal. I tried to run the ship properly with the book, but they fought me at every turn. If the crew wanted to walk around with their shirt tails hanging out, that's all right. Let them. Take the tow line. Defective equipment. No more, no less. But they encouraged the crew to go around scoffing at me and spreading wild rumors about steaming in circles and then old Yellowstone. I was to blame for Lieutenant Merrick.